Good morning and welcome everyone to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. I am located at 1563 Main Street in Peckville, and I'm here every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. on these stations to provide landowners valuable information that you need regarding the natural gas development here in Pennsylvania. And again, as always, if you are looking for landowner information, this is the show for you. What I do at the Clark Law Firm is I represent landowners, and of course only landowners, no companies, no gas companies, no pipeline companies, only landowners related to oil and gas issues. For such items as, of course, gas lease negotiations, I've done hundreds and hundreds of gas lease negotiations on behalf of Pennsylvania landowners, doing a lot of and have done a lot of pipeline right-of-way agreements and continue. I think I have several more clients this week for pipeline right-of-way agreements across the state of Pennsylvania, new clients. And that is the area where I would say that I get the most calls and the most activity, is there are so many different pipeline projects going on across the state. And what's interesting for us too is often we can kind of tell when a company out there, a pipeline company, is going out to buy a new route, because we start getting calls from that particular county and more specifically that particular township. You've heard me say before, I've reached, or let's say entered into and have been involved in negotiations with, I'm gonna be conservative and say maybe just shy, but certainly in that 45 to 50 different companies that I've negotiated with and communicated with on behalf of clients regarding potential pipeline agreements. So it gives you an idea as to what's really going on out there, but also the idea of the way in which people can get experience, or, you know, that I'm able to obtain additional experience by dealing with all of these different companies in a lot of different ways too, because sometimes the company has a lot of leverage because, say, they have the ability to install a pipeline under the terms of your gas lease. So you have to understand that, and you have to say, okay, what are my options here? How can I make the best of this situation? Do I have to agree? But even if I have to agree, what can I control? What type of input can I have? And pretty much, there's always something you can do. You know, I'm going to talk some about pipelines, or quite a bit about pipelines today, and I know I do a lot of shows about pipelines, but again, as I say, it's because that this is an area that's so active right now, and it's so important. So we got, you know, three or four new clients this past week for pipeline projects. So it just gives you an idea. You know, this is the thing. You know, this is going on, and we have clients all across the state. I said I've worked with probably close to 50 companies. It might even be more than 50 different companies with pipeline right-of-way agreements. And I was just sitting here getting ready for the show, writing down some companies that I've recently or currently am working with or negotiating. You know, they've got Williams, Angelina, Access Midstream, Appalachian Midstream, EOG, Regency, PVR, Shell / SWEPI, IMG, NRG, WPX, Chief, DTE, SGC, Susquehanna Gathering Corporation, Bluestone, UGI, just finished up a couple big agreements with UGI, the Constitution Pipeline Project, the Sunrise Pipeline Project, Anadarko. You know, that's about 20 companies just right there that I'm either active with or have very recently been active with in negotiations, and some of these companies with multiple landowners and files. So it gives you an idea. And I just think it's important that you understand, you know, there's a lot going on. What that also means is because of this activity, there's a body of experience that's available for everybody now to learn from and to work off of. And what I say that is, and, you know, again, if it's not me, somebody else, but on pipeline right-of-way agreements, if you are not being represented by legal counsel who is experienced and understands what your leverage is and what you can do, if you're not being represented, I'm telling you, you're doing yourself a major disservice. Not only could you be missing out on a lot of compensation, but also you can be missing out on additional addendum terms which can result in one or two things, and usually both, can result in additional compensation. And usually in virtually every case that I'm involved in, usually we're able to increase the compensation or structure the compensation in a way that's going to make this make sense for you having an attorney. It doesn't make sense, okay? You don't want to sit there and spend, you know, $1,000, $2,000 on an attorney and only get $500 by signing an agreement. And then if the company doesn't use that agreement, well, you just spent an extra $500 to $1,500 in my example, and nothing happened. So you have to be mindful of that. But a good attorney is going to be mindful of that too and have that discussion with you. And so these option agreements where a company will say, hey, landowner, we want you to sign this agreement. We're going to give you $500 today or $500 within a month after you sign the agreement. And then we'll decide over the next 2, 3, 5, or sometimes even more years whether we're actually going to build this pipeline. And if we do build the pipeline, then we're going to give you that bigger payment in the future, somewhere, say, $15, $20, $25, maybe $35, $40. They're going to give you that in the future. But if they don't decide to actually exercise this option or do this agreement or construct the pipelines, if they decide not to do that, well, you don't get that secondary payment. So you're sitting there, as any reasonable person would, and say, well, look, I got this agreement. They're going to give me $500. If I go to an attorney, it's going to probably cost more than $500. And I'm going to tell you, it is. I mean, if your attorney knows what he or she is doing, they're going to provide you a service. It's going to take more time than what $500 would get you, but it's also going to give you benefits that, you know, should far exceed that money. But And I mean, this is, you have to be aware of this, and your lawyer, your counsel has to be aware of this. If you're only going to get $500, does it make sense for you to have a $1,500 legal fee if you don't know they're going to do this agreement or use this and construct these pipelines? Well, now you're going to be out money, and you're sitting there saying, well, geez, I just spent money, didn't get anything, and wasted time and money. Well, you got to watch out for that. So a lot of times, with most of these companies, and dealing with them in the volume and the experience and dealing with these companies, to say, look, it's going to cost this landowner maybe $1,500, $2,000, and every case is different. Could be less, could be more. It's going to cost them some money to do this. It's really not fair that you give them this agreement for $500 that they signed today, and then you may not use it in the future. So these landowners should at least, at the bare minimum, not have costs with their legal fees and their time. They should not have costs that exceed the amount of money that you're going to give them up front to sign the documents. So many companies we work with will increase that bonus, or excuse me, that option payment, that first payment. They'll increase it from $500 to some higher amount, and depending upon the leverage in your particular circumstance, again, depending upon what we can do, sometimes we can increase that drastically. Sometimes the company says, hey, you know, we don't know that we're really going to use this, so we only want to increase it by $1,000, couple thousand dollars. But my goal, knowing what I would want if I was in that landowner's shoes, is to make sure that you don't walk out of this deal and you don't look back in months in the future and say, wow, why did I do that? Or even years in the future, that just cost me money and I received no benefit. The only one that made out from this deal was the lawyer. So what do we want to do? We want to make sure that we avoid that situation. You know, one of the things I'm very proud about on the websites, you know, we're very proud of about the landowner testimonials that we receive. And I think it says that there's 80 some up there, but I think we have actually a lot more. And we're working on a new site, so I'm very excited about that. But, you know, go check out those testimonials. And even again, if you're not even hiring me, you know, go check that out to see what landowners, kind of the perspective is after representation and agreement. What I mean is you'll see a lot of people saying, hey, really glad I hired the Clark Law Firm. And this could be somebody else. Again, this isn't to be a commercial for me. What I'm saying is, my point is, if you look at those testimonials, you can read what real people write. hey, glad I hired these guys. Glad I hired Doug because maybe I got more money. Or, hey, he explained everything, so now I really understand what I'm doing and I can make this decision more comfortably. Or, hey, he made this agreement so much better and gave me or got me additional terms that I didn't even know were available. These pipelines, it's so common to be able to ask certain questions or get language changed in agreements that does significantly increase the landowner's compensation. Simple example. Say, for example, you didn't know that you could ask for the same amount of money if the company was going to put in a second line, a second pipeline. A lot of times, companies don't tell you that. They give you an agreement that says that they can put in one or more lines. Well, most companies will pay you, most, not all, but most will pay you again if they put in a second line. But if you don't know to ask that, well, most companies aren't going to tell you that they'll do that. Most of the landmen aren't going to tell you that. So, simple example, and we see this. I mean, I've had this happen multiple times. Say it's a major pipeline project, and the person's going to get, pick a number. I'm going to give you a high number. Say they're going to get $100,000 for the pipeline. There's a long pipeline going in the property. Well, just by asking, we're able to get another $100,000 for the second pipeline that they put in. So just, you have to understand and you have to know what to ask for. Then also, you know, here you are sitting at your kitchen table with the landman saying, hey, well, you know, I heard this guy on the radio. He said, you know, we can ask for equal compensation the next time. And he may say, well, you know, they don't do that. Well, maybe they don't, but maybe they do. So that's an area too where an experienced lawyer, experienced counsel can tell you, hey, look, I've dealt with these guys before. We went around this circle before. And they may say that they don't do this, but I know for a fact that they've done it. And I think we can do it in your case. And here's my recommendation and my advice as to how I think, you know, how I would recommend that you handle this in order to maximize that compensation. What can you get? And that value there, you know, sometimes we see these numbers just double. Other times, I'm able to look at this and understand and see this leverage that you have and give our best estimate as to what the leverage is. I can't tell you how many times I talk to landowners who come into the office or we have a call and they tell me, hey, look, you know, we have all this leverage. We really got them in a pinch. And sometimes it's true, but more often than not, landowners are overestimating their leverage in that circumstance. Now, on the flip side, very important, on the flip side, many other landowners call me and say, oh, hey, I got this agreement. Just want to know, how's this look? I think it looks good. Maybe I'm going to go ahead and sign it. Say, whoa, 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 we need to talk. I'm never going to obstruct you. I'm never going to tell you, don't do this, don't do this. But what I'm going to do is tell you all the good points and I'm going to tell you all the bad points. So you make that decision. You know, it's not about trying to blow something up. Not about, hey, instead of asking for $50,000, you should ask for $500,000. There's times when maybe that's what you should do. But if I would say to you, hey, you know what, I think you can get a whole lot more money, and you say, well, you know, I would rather ask for something much less. Well, that's your choice. A good lawyer, to me, tells you all the different factors, all the different issues, gives you those pros and cons, and helps to guide you to make the best decision for yourself. Now, sometimes the lawyer can give you a strong recommendation. Sometimes they can't. But ultimately, the final decision is always yours. And the best information that you can get is going to give you the ability to make the best decision possible. All right, I'm up as usual over my break time. So I'll be right back after this break. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, attorney Doug Clark. I'll be right back. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, attorney Doug Clark. And again, I'm here every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. on these stations. Have been doing this radio show since August of 2010. And in that time frame, I've talked about pipelines quite a bit. And this just gives you an idea. I look at issues. I look for things what would I want to know if I was a landowner? What do I need to try to get out there for landowners to be thinking about? And if you're a regular listener to the show, you say, well, geez, you know, he's talking about pipelines a lot. Well, there's a reason, because it's so important. And it's something that I really can't overstate. It's talking about, you know, within just the last 6 months, I think I've done work with about 20 different companies just in the last 6 months, including Active Files. And so it's so important. There's so much work going on out there. And another thing that's really interesting and really fascinates me, you know, doing this work across the state, we kind of get this, like, almost like imagine an aerial view as to what's going on. And in some areas, the pipeline process is far more advanced than other areas. For example, you know, Williams has done so much work in Susquehanna County and have done so many pipeline agreements dating back to, you know, 2010 and probably even earlier than that. Done hundreds probably of pipeline agreements and similar agreements with Williams in Susquehanna County primarily, but other areas as well. So that's been going on. We have a 4-year look back period, say, and probably even bigger than that, but just as an example. So we can see how this thing evolved. And over time, a company like Williams were paying less money earlier. Now their standard general offer has increased quite a bit. So what do we see? What can we take from that? Also, you know, the evolution of negotiations. If we're able to negotiate something, we're able to obtain some terms, then of course we want to be looking at that for the future. You know, there's other times where I have clients that have a lot of leverage, and then some clients that don't have a lot of leverage. So evaluate the leverage and how can we use that to benefit this particular individual. But looking again, still at this overview. So we have, just using this example, one company that we can really kind of watch what's happened. We can see how much work they've done. We can look at our base of negotiation in history. We can see what happened with clients with more leverage, less leverage, and how can I maximize this particular next client's situation and circumstances. So, okay, that's obviously a tremendous value, and it's also going to be much more time efficient. Now, let's turn this over, and I want to talk about a company staying in Susquehanna County here for a minute. But again, everyone, this applies across the state. Just using this example, you take a company, Angelina Gathering Corporation, AGC. They're doing work for Southwestern, putting in pipelines in Susquehanna County. Now, Southwestern is a little bit behind, or somewhat behind, however we want to say it, Cabot, where Williams is doing a lot of the pipeline work and installing the pipeline infrastructure system for Cabot. Well, Angelina, subsidiary of Southwestern, remember that, that's important, but not for today's purposes. But Angelina is, or AGC, is a subsidiary of Southwestern. Those are always a little bit concerning, because then we start to wonder when they start charging fees to Southwestern. So when their affiliate, not subsidiary, affiliate, excuse me. So when an affiliate is charging their affiliate, is that an arm's length transaction, and how are those fees going to be? So something certain that we're going to be keeping our eyes on in the future. But for today's purposes, my point here is we're talking, we take a company like Williams, who I've been working with for years on behalf of landowner clients in Susquehanna County primarily, but also in some other areas, but primarily Susquehanna County. So we watch this evolution. We're integrally involved in this process of negotiations over these years. So at the beginning, there wasn't a lot of wells going on, or there wasn't that much drilling activity. And what we see is landowners are very excited about the proposition or the possibility of getting royalties. So, how many times do I say this? It's not these companies' first rodeos, that's for sure. Not their first rodeos. So, they say, well, at the beginning, it's kind of easier to get landowners to sign these pipeline right-of-way agreements, because you're saying, hey, look, we need to get these pipelines in the ground to get you royalties. Royalties, royalties, royalties. That's where the big money is. This is kind of the script that they read off of. So, but it's, I mean, part of it's obviously true. You can't get royalties unless you're piping this gas out of the, out of, off the wells and out into the market. So they say, hey, we need to get this. And so here's these landowners, and a lot of them maybe signed at $25, $50, or $100. But even if you signed it more for your gas lease, talking about your bonus for your gas lease, they're saying, well, geez, the big money is where royalty is. So, hey, I need to get this thing signed and get this in the ground. Well, look, you may be making the old double mistake. The first mistake, and not to beat on it, but first mistake is, hey, maybe you should have had some more information before you signed your gas lease. Well, learn from that and say, well, maybe I need to get some more information before I sign this pipeline agreement. So that's number one. I mean, again, I don't care if it's me. I mean, hey, look, I shouldn't say I don't care. I love to represent everybody I can, but you need to have somebody working with you. And also, my opinion, you need somebody with a lot of experience and somebody that you're comfortable with, somebody that's going to communicate with you, somebody that you're comfortable the way they handle things. That is critical, because if you get a good lawyer and you develop this relationship for your gas lease or your pipeline, then you have a royalty issue, then you have an estate planning issue, you have somebody who you're comfortable with who can help you out through the process. But these gas pipeline agreements, there's something that you need to have representation on, because they are terrible the way they're presented. And a good lawyer is going to change that document drastically. And I mean that drastically for your benefit. People signing these bare bones pipeline agreements are making big mistakes. I truly believe that, because I also see people who got property, whereas people signed bad pipeline agreements 50 years ago, you know, 70 years ago. I have one in the 1800s, and it's haunting these people. Here you're going to see these agreements come back and bite you in a lot of cases in the next 5 years, 10 years. You have to be protecting yourself and getting the best agreement. I am Attorney Doug Clark. You're listening to All Things Marcellus. Again, I'm here every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. Also, you can go check us out. You have to go to pagasleaseattorney.com and pipelineattorney.com. A lot of great information there. Go check out the sites. Here's the other thing. Go check them out now, and we are in the process. I got a lot going on with the websites. I'm really excited about it. It's going to take a little bit of time, but finally, we are going to be doing some really neat stuff with the websites, changing things around. I know it's going to be a lot better. So go check it out now. Get a flavor, get a taste. We get a lot of compliments from the sites now, but I think, well, I know they're going to be a whole lot better, and that's going to be a change that's coming around here pretty soon. So check them out now. Get a good base feel. But again, it's not even about if you're looking for representation or not. Get information. Get information. And I believe confidently that our sites are a good area. Again, pagasleaseattorney.com, pipelineattorney.com. And I'll just say, you know, if you are looking for representation, you can always call me. This isn't to be a commercial, but you can always contact me, 570-307-0702. That's 570-307-0702. You know, I have clients, literally, who own land or mineral rights, gas rights, all across Pennsylvania. We just finished up our client's big lease agreement with a bunch of people who are relatives out in Washington County with Range Resources. And I mentioned this before, my client was actually a landman, a gas company landman in Texas, was my main lead client contact. So it tells you, a landman who's been doing this for many years calls and says, I need to get a lawyer to represent me in this process. That's telling you, the landman for the company, not this company, works for a different company for many years, says, I need to get me a Pennsylvania lawyer who knows what they're doing to negotiate and help us out with this. So if that doesn't tell you that you need to be getting assistance, and I'm telling you, I'm not sitting here saying, hire a lawyer, hire a lawyer, hire a lawyer. If you have to do this, if you have these agreements and you're going to sign something, you really do need to have an attorney and somebody who's experienced, and it doesn't have to be me, but please make sure it's someone. So it's not like I just want to say, call me, call me, call me. It needs to be somebody who's experienced that can help you out. this agreement with this particular person, I mean, just the bonus and the change of the compensation structure, hundreds of thousands of dollars in difference. Also, the terms. I mean, it's a complicated negotiation, and they made out very, very well in this process. And, you know, I have to say that, you know, I certainly don't believe they would have done this well on their own. And I know this person was very, very happy. And I know that they'll be ultimately, they'll be submitting a testimonial and say, hey, put this on your website. And that's what we try to do. You know, we want to make sure you're not going to be very popular if you're not doing a good job for people. And also, you know, communicating with your client. You want to make sure, too, if you're going in to talk to an attorney, hey, you know, how are we going to communicate? We want to make sure that we're going to have this communication, because unfortunately, that doesn't always occur. Again, I am Attorney Doug Clark, listening to All Things Marcellus. I'm here every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. to give landowners information you need as landowners regarding the gas development here in Pennsylvania. So I want to circle back around here. Got a little off track. I want to talk about, you know, say, I was mentioning Angelina. This is a good example again. Talking about Susquehanna County here, but it can be anywhere in the state. So working with Williams over the past many years, several years, have seen the prices go up, have seen the agreements evolve. Early on in the process, the first people, first clients, first landowners, first individuals that Williams landmen went out to, they were real quick to sign. They were slow to negotiate, quick to sign, because they said, hey, we want to get royalties. Also, some of them signed for low bonus and low gas or low royalty percentage, so they wanted to hurry up and sign because they wanted to see the royalty or the bigger money. Also, maybe they didn't get a lot of money for their gas lease, so they're a little concerned about calling a lawyer because they say, geez, I hardly got any money at all. I don't want to keep spending money. I'd like to see some money. I would like to see some royalties. So I'm just not going to incur this expense and just go ahead and sign. Understandable. You know, we understand those things. But you need to acquire the information. You need to find out, hey, you know, what could a lawyer maybe do for me? Do I need a lawyer? So anyway, backing up. So a lot of people were just signing these earlier on. Well, now, as time goes, the easy people who sign quick, sign. Now you have some other people that maybe are a little more skeptical, or some other people that said, hey, you know what? I got a nice bonus. I'm not afraid to go talk to an attorney to make sure I'm maximizing this. So I'm going to go and speak with somebody. And then when they talk to an attorney, a knowledgeable attorney who tells them what they need to know, then they may say, you know what? This isn't enough money. Or I need to get some better terms of this agreement. So then that negotiation process starts. Well, the company now, in order to get people to sign, is forced to negotiate with this kind of second tier of landowner. Then you keep moving forward. Well, what about now, all of a sudden, you do have landowners who are getting royalties, and a pipeline company knocks on their door and says, hey, we'd like to put a pipeline in your property. Landers was, geez, you know, I'm getting royalties. I'm pretty happy. I maybe already have a pipeline. I don't want to burden my property with more pipelines or anything above ground. You know, thanks, but no thanks. Well, the company says, well, you know, we really need to do this. Well, the landowner says, well, if you really need to do it, maybe I'm interested, but instead of $25,000 you're offering me, I wouldn't do it unless you're paying me $100,000. Well, you'd be surprised many times that's something that can occur. The key is to understand, are you in that situation? And then also you have to be prepared that you may say a number, in my example, you may say $100,000 and the company says, nah, that's just too high. Thanks, but no thanks. We're moving on. And if you're okay with that, that's good. You know, those are the people who get the best pipeline agreements. Those are the ones. All right, again, I'm up over it. I want to talk about, you know, when I get back, I'm going to explain this. I'm going to bring this around, I promise, and talk about like a company like Angelina, AGC, and see, you know, what we're seeing with them and where they are kind of compared to Williams from my perspective. Be right back after this break. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Be right back. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. Again, here every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. on these stations. Been doing the show since August of 2010. You can go to the websites, pagasleaseattorney.com. That's pagasleaseattorney.com. Also, pipelineattorney.com. Check out the websites. A lot of great information. The show theme, the idea, is to get you as the landowner education, credible, reliable information, get you thinking about some things that maybe you're not already thinking about. You know, you have been thrusted, you've been thrust as a landowner into this big business. You know, these pipelines are legal contracts affecting your property. In most cases, our land, you know, our houses, our property are the largest assets that we own. So these are legal contracts impacting this asset. You need to make sure that when you're entering into these legal contracts, that you do have representation and that you understand what you're doing. The company has representation. We've seen what's going on with leases. I see it all the time. The results of people signing poor pipeline agreements. You need to make sure in any contract you're going to write your name down on. Remember, this is big business. Maybe you never dealt with this type of stuff before. Most people haven't, but you've been thrust into this arena, and you need to make sure that you're protecting yourself. You need to make sure. So get information, but ultimately, I'm telling you, if you're going to sign a contract, make sure you have representation. I see it too many times. I have clients who come to me and say, hey, I have a pipeline agreement, so we're going to work on that. Or they have a damage release for a well site, or they're getting a well site, or the company wants to put a roadway or something on the property. So they then hire me, and I never represented them before, or we didn't have any interaction before. And they start sending me documents that they've entered into in the past, like a gas lease that was, you know, maybe not negotiated. And, you know, I say this to you, as long as you do as good as you can at the time, you know, you've done a good job. You have to be informed to make sure you're maximizing your circumstances. And you make an informed decision, then you've done a good job for yourself. Okay, but the problem is if you signed an agreement in 2009 and it's a bare bones agreement, well, the problem you have there is, had you worked with somebody that knew what they were doing, you would have had a much better agreement. And maybe that agreement would have precluded deductions being taken for gathering and transportation. Maybe you could have had a higher royalty percentage. Those kind of changes can be tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, and depending upon, you know, the size of the property and the production, even millions of dollars. So those are extreme examples, but you have to be doing this. Pipelines are just simply easier. Those pipeline, when I mean easier, it's easier to see the faults. These agreements that they're presenting to you, if you don't have addendum terms to those agreements, that's just terrible. It's a terrible circumstance, and you have to make sure that you're not doing that. I just hate to see that. It's something that's going to come back to bite people. It already is, and the companies are still getting people to sign these agreements, and they're very, very bad. I'm not making this up. You know, I've done other shows on it. I'm going to talk some more. I'm going to give you an example here today, but they're very bad. So circling back, okay, finally. So I talked about, you know, I've done agreements with Williams for pipeline agreements since at least 2010, maybe even earlier. Probably done hundreds of right-of-way and other agreements like surface agreements, meter sites, pig launchers, valves, those type of things, workspace, all kinds of other different agreements as well. Well, what we saw early on was not a lot of pushback from landowners. Not a lot of pushback, so easy to sign the agreements. As time has gone on over the last few years, landowners have gotten wiser. Also, landowners, maybe some are even actually starting to see royalties, so they're not as desperate to be talked into or easy to talk them into signing the agreement because they're desperate to see this royalty income. You know, those, I love when I get those clients who say, okay, look, let's take a step back. Let's see if you have the ability to say no, and let's talk about, do you want to do this? And let's all have this conversation early, right at the beginning, because you don't want to pay me $1,000 or $2,000 and then decide that this isn't something you want to do. We need to know right up front, do you want to do this? Let's get a plan together that's going to work for you. Let's assess your leverage and let's decide, do you even want to go forward? it is not terribly uncommon that I have this initial conference or conversation with the landowner, and we talk about all these different options. They say, you know what? Yeah, maybe I don't want to do this. Or, and you know, that's, you know, that it's work that I say, hey, look, I think it makes sense. So I'm giving away work, but that's what your job is, you know, to advise the person, you know, make sure that they understand and to make sure they're making a fully informed decision. Also, they may say, well, you know what? I really don't want to do this, but if they paid me blank, whatever that number is, well, then maybe I'd then I'd do it. So what do we want to do then? We want to say to the pipeline company, hey, company, look, the landowner's not crazy about this, and we understand that you may have some other options, and that's fine. If you want to use their property or you want to do this, instead of the, say, $25,000 that they're offering, they'll only do it if you pay them $75,000. Or $100,000, whatever that number is, and say, well, company, if you want to do that, if that's what you want to do, then let's go ahead and keep moving on this. Let's go ahead and work out an agreement. If that's too much money, hey, that's okay. Go ahead, find another route. Landowner is okay. They don't mind not having a pipeline on their property. Again, they do not mind not having construction and installation of a pipeline on their property, which will devalue their property in some fashion, will devalue it. Nobody says, oh boy, this property has a pipeline easement on it, I'm going to give you some more money for that. You're not going to see that. So you say, you know what, I'm willing to pass on it. So what does that do? That creates a market where landowners, now there's less of them that are, you know, jumping at the opportunity, if you want to call it that, to have a pipeline agreement. So now you're starting to see these numbers and the compensation that landowners are receiving go higher, and landowners are becoming wiser. And maybe a landowner that I represented, we were able to do some things in before. Now a different company knocks on their door. So we say, okay, let's sit back and talk about this and talk about what your options are. Do we want to move forward? How do we want to move forward? These are always those initial discussions should be, what are your options? What are your leverage? What is your ability to say no? What does this mean to you? Is this a hunting property? Is this where you live? Where do they want to put it? All of these things are very important, critical factors to be discussed right at the beginning. I am Attorney Doug Clark. You're listening to All Things Marcellus. I'm here every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. on these stations. Been doing the show now over four years. So, again, I'm circling back here. So I've been talking about Williams and this evolution of what we've been seeing. Well, let's jump to Angelina Gathering Company, or AGC, who is doing a lot of the pipeline work for Southwestern. They're an affiliated company of Southwestern. DTE is another company that we're seeing doing some of this pipeline work for Southwestern. So like Williams does the pipeline infrastructure and enters into agreements with Cabot to transport their gas, Angelina right now is dealing with Southwestern, affiliated company, and Southwestern is also dealing with what I'm seeing with a company called DTE. So what are we seeing? Well, Southwestern is very active now in Susquehanna County. But in my experience, they haven't been as active in the county, say, as what Cabot has been in the past. And also, you know, Southwestern acquired a bunch of acreage from Chesapeake last year. So over the last year. So again, you know, they're just starting to crank up development and get this stuff rolling. So what we're seeing is, you know, look at this as a timeline and say, well, Williams is far more advanced. They've been doing this for a few years much more aggressively than what Angelina has. Well, Angelina now, if you're thinking of 1 to 10 on the timeline here, making this up for illustration, maybe Williams is at 6, 7 along this chart, this timeline, where Angelina is only at maybe, you know, 1 or 2 in this process. So what can we do? Well, we can look at, well, remember when Williams was kind of early on and how this thing evolved, and what can we learn from that? Well, also, what I'm seeing is Angelina has been able to get landowners to sign these right-of-way agreements that they're presenting, which in my opinion are very poor, documents for landowners, not very friendly with landowners. So you're able to get them to sign because landowners are still in this earlier phase with them. They're in this phase of, well, nobody's getting royalties, and the landman said, can't get royalties unless you got pipelines. Royalties are where the big money is. Well, I better hurry up and sign this document. And Angelina, in most cases, to my knowledge, is still offering, well, we'll give you $600 to sign this option agreement. Whoa, geez, $600? If that's all they're going to give me, if I go and hire a lawyer, it's certainly going to cost more than $600. So I could end up, you know, if it costs me $1,600 for a lawyer, I end up losing $1,000 or paying that money now when, if they use this agreement in the future and I get more money, I'm already out $1,000 now, or I pay a lawyer $1,600, I only get $600, and then the company doesn't use this agreement? Well, geez, now I'm really not happy. Why did I ever do that? So, well, you know what? Royalties where the money is. And the landman tells me, well, this is what everybody else is signing. So, you know what? Let me just go ahead and sign this and keep my fingers crossed that I'm going to get big royalties in the future. I'm telling you, not the way to handle it. Not the way to handle it. Many times, and can't get too specific, but I'll just say this. What I would do if I was engaged in discussions with Angelina in my example would be, first, let's assess the leverage. Let's figure it all out. What are your options? What can you do? Can you say yes? Can you say no? How important is this? Where is it going to be? How much money are we talking about? And, okay, Angelina, if we're going to do this, we're going to need more than $600 up front. And let's get an estimate. Let's figure out what we can do to make sure you as a landowner aren't going to come out short on this. And then, if we can get that worked out, then let's start banging out these terms and let's make sure that we're doing this as efficiently as possible. And your agreement that you're presenting is very company friendly. So we really need to do some work on this. And you're going to be a lot better off if you're out there by yourself and this is the first time or your lawyer's first time in doing this. You know, you're inventing the wheel here. And you got to go through this. And there are so many issues with the standard form that companies present. So if we're able to start at a point beyond that or base off of prior work that we've done with any of the companies, that's going to be a big benefit for you. So when you say, hey, I want to make sure that they can't put in more than two pipelines, say, we say, look, you know, we've asked that question 50 times in the past on behalf of 50 different landowners, and here's what we've been able to do. Now, we can do whatever you want to do. We'll ask for whatever you want to ask, but let's talk realistically. What is our experience with this company? What is our experience with other companies on that request? And that is an extremely valuable tool for you as a landowner to maximize your agreement. So what I'm saying is, like with this Angelina example, I'm seeing people out there signing these agreements, and it's just like kind of like what people did with my example in Williams early on. Well, we want to get royalties, we're not seeing a lot of activity, let's sign these pipeline agreements and get this thing rolling. Well, watch these, because I say it with the option. Companies say, well, we want to get this done, we want to start next year, we want to start in the fall, we want to start in the winter. Well, as always, you want to find out how serious they are about that, ask them to put that into the agreement. Well, you're never going to see that. They're not going to do that. So they're saying, hey, we want to get this done, we want to get you royalties. Well, how long do you have to put the pipelines in the ground? Not necessarily how long until you pay me, but how long until they go in the ground? And if they're telling you we can't commit to put these in the ground for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, well, that's telling you, is this really a big hurry? I'm going to talk more about what we can learn in this evolutionary process for the pipelines and what we, you know, how we use that to the landowner's advantage when I get back after this break. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark, here every Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. and be right back after this break. Welcome back to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark of the Clark Law Firm. reminder again, a couple things. Check out PAGasLeaseAttorney.com. Check out PipelineAttorney.com. Haven't been there in a while. Go check them out. We're doing major renovations, something I'm very excited about. I've been working quite a bit on this behind the scenes, so it's going to still take a little bit of time here, but we are going to be launching some new websites in the next couple months, so very excited about that, and I think it's going to be much easier to follow, doing some really exciting things, so very, very excited about that. Also, reminder, you can check out the show. You miss any of today's shows, any of the other shows dating back to August of 2010, you can check out PAGasLeaseAttorney.com. Also, YouTube. You can go to YouTube, type in Doug Clark, All Things Marcellus. Check it out there as well. We post those shows up Monday morning. Want to make sure that you get quick access. You can also podcast on iTunes. Type in All Things Marcellus. Of course, everything is free information. Check it out there. Download it. Listen to whatever you want. We want to make sure that you have access to this information. We want to make sure that you're thinking about these things that you need to be thinking about, that your parents are thinking about them, your children are thinking about them, making sure that your mind is working on this stuff. It doesn't end in gas leases by any means. And doing a lot more in recent times as clients, people were saying, is this going to play out? Is it not going to play out? What's going to happen? Well, now we're starting to see a lot more of our clients getting royalty statements. And so doing more with estate planning. How are you going to handle your estate? What's the best way to structure this as you go forward? And now you're starting to see some reality to this situation. And it's always, it's never too early. And it's never too late to start looking at these estate planning issues. So certainly, doing a lot more of that as well. And as I said before, represent landowners all across the state of Pennsylvania, all across the state. Active files in Armstrong County, Washington County, and many others out there in the western part, where I'm actually from, Armstrong County, born and raised and grew up in Armstrong County. With that said, I want to go back now again. You're listening to All Things Marcellus with me, Attorney Doug Clark, here every Sunday from 8 to 9 on these stations. So I want to go back, explaining this situation in Susquehanna County, where what we can do is we can learn from other experiences. Makes sense, doesn't it? Well, one of the things that we can learn from or we can see is that not all pipeline companies are kind of like in the same step of progress as the other companies. What I mean by that is, for example, Williams does midstream or gathering pipeline work, installing pipelines and transports gas for Cabot. Okay, that's the pipeline company, Williams, that does a lot of that work for Cabot. Now, other companies have different pipeline companies, like Chief often is using now, they used to use PVR, and Regency is now the company doing a lot of the work for them. Chesapeake using Appalachian Midstream or AMS, Access Midstream, but now also there's a relationship between Williams and these companies, but they're keeping the same names. So we want to be aware of that. But these are examples. And so what else do we see? Another company now is that we're seeing a lot more of and doing a lot more agreements and more clients and more calls are for Southwestern's companies that are doing the pipeline work, and that's Angelina Gathering Company. AGC are the initials. Also, a company called DTE is doing some work for Southwestern. And what we're seeing is, because Southwestern, they're kind of a little behind on the development. They acquired a bunch of leases and acreage from Chesapeake in Susquehanna County. So they're just, Cabot has been more aggressively developing for a longer period of time, which means also that Williams has been more active acquiring easements and rights of way in Susquehanna County over the past several years. So what we're seeing, and as I step back and I can look at this from seeing all these different types of agreements, we're seeing that similarly to what landowners were doing with Williams in 2009, 10, 11, we're seeing landowners sign pretty poor agreements with Southwestern's companies who are doing their work, the Angelina Gathering Company, AGC, or DTE. And we're seeing agreements that, I think aren't up to standard based upon what the market is. And why is that happening? Well, just like what was going on years ago when Williams first started buying rights at much lower rates than what they're buying today, what happened was that landowners are looking into the future about these royalties. And the landman says to them, hey, we're not getting royalties to you guys, and royalties where the big money is, so we need to get these pipeline right-of-way agreements. Here, sign on this line, we'll get this thing rolling. So because this is the first time people are seeing this, because they may, you know, they're frustrated and they're looking for royalties, they're going to be much more inclined to sign. Because, most important, because this isn't something that they've been seeing a lot of, they don't know what you can do about this or what you should be doing. So we're seeing people, similarly to what we saw years ago with Williams, we're seeing people sign what I consider to be pretty poor agreements with Angelina and other companies because this is the early phase of them acquiring these rights. I am very confident that what we'll see over the next 5 years or few years are that these agreements, the terms, are going to become more favorable for landowners. As the people who are just going to sign, hurry up and sign, and the company still needs right-of-way agreements, they're going to be approaching other landowners who are going to be a little more skeptical, who are going to do what they should do and go get experienced counsel to assist them, and they're going to find out, whoa, we have some other rights here. Let's make sure we're maximizing the compensation. We don't have to say yes to this. Let's make sure we're getting the best possible agreement. And so what the companies do now, before it gets more difficult, they dig in, boy. They dig in hard to try to keep these prices as low as they can, to try to offer the lowest and the fewest terms that they can, because it's like a dam. As it opens and that water starts pouring out, it's hard to plug it. So they're trying to keep this dam as tight as possible. They don't want more money to start flowing out. They don't want better terms to start flowing out, because once they do, well, you can't stop it in most cases. So they're very, and it's the same thing. You know, it's the same thing we saw with Williams, the same thing with other companies. But as you have less options as a company, as you need landowners and you don't have the authority to shove it down their throat with the gas lease, well, now that landowner can say no to you. And if they say no to you, and you and all the people say no, or you can't get around these people, or you need to use this right away, what do you do? What can you do? What has every other company done in that situation? Because you have no other choice. What have they done? They've offered more money. They've offered better terms. They have no choice. You know, just like I said, I mean, my favorite client to get for pipelines is somebody who's getting royalties that says, look, I really don't care about this pipeline. I don't need it. I don't really want it. But if they want to pay me whatever blank amount, whatever that number is, well then, okay, it makes sense. And what we do, we attack that number first. Hey, company, look, my client is getting money on royalties. My client loves their property. My client already agreed to a pipeline. Maybe they didn't. Whatever the case may be, they really, you know, they're not crazy about this and they don't need it. They're not worried about, oh man, if I don't agree to this, I'm not going to get my money for royalties, which was landmen sell to people all the time. They say, I don't really need this. So the only way I'm going to do it is if you're going to pay me this higher compensation. And again, every case is different, but I've seen numbers go up unbelievably high. And it depends on the circumstances. And what happens is you owe it to yourself to find out what your circumstances are. And maybe the best thing for you is to say, you know what? No, no, thank you. So back to, you know, we got Angelina out here and it's early on in the process. So what do you need to do? As a landowner, it's as important as ever to figure out, okay, where do I fit in this? And they're saying this is what we pay. They're going to say this is what we pay everybody. But I will guarantee you that people will get paid more than what they're saying that they're paying people. Guarantee it's going to happen. It always does. It will happen. So we want to make sure that we're looking at your situation. You're understanding what your leverage is. This dam is going to start breaking open. They're trying to keep it shut. You know, they're trying to keep this thing plugged. They're trying to keep it so nothing's getting out. But it will break open. So the question is when and how much? Well, the better job that we do, the better job that you do, is going to help, you know, yourself, obviously. But you're going to see that everybody is going to end up benefiting, or almost everybody, but these numbers are going to go higher. You know, they always have, and they will, because they're going to run out of things that they can just simply do. They're going to run out of agreements that they can say, we can put this in under the gas lease, and now they're going to have to really negotiate. And that's where it comes to, is this worth this to you, and how do you want to handle this? So important that you're getting that information today and that you're maximizing your circumstances today, that you're not getting kind of bamboozled into, hey, we can do this anyway. We can do it under the lease. This is what we pay everybody. Here, sign here, sign here. Don't do that. Please, whether it's me or somebody else, you must get this information. You must understand what you're doing. You must maximize your agreement. You owe it to yourself and you owe it to your family. I am Attorney Doug Clark. This is All Things Marcellus. I'll be back next Sunday from 8 to 9 a.m. Have a great week, everyone.